Fred Snodgrass, Bill Buckner, and Steve Bartman all have something in common. Do you know what it is? All three of these men made a famous, if not infamous, mistake. And many remember them simply for the mistake that they made. Here's a brief synopsis of each. Fred Snodgrass was an outfielder for the New York Giants. You know, this goes back a long time when we say baseball is the New York Giants. He was playing center field in the 1912 World Series against what would be the future hated rival of the Yankees, the Boston Red Sox. The game was tied, it was the 10th inning, and a fly ball was hit towards Fred Snodgrass. He eyed it up, it hit his mitt, and it dropped on the ground. The New York Giants went on to lose the World Series, and this error by Fred Snodgrass was looked at as the turning point in the series. Bill Buckner is the first baseman for the Boston Red Sox. He was playing in Game 6 of the World Series against the New York Mets. The game was tied, bases were loaded, and a soft grounder was hit to first base. It hit Bill Buckner's glove, and then it squirted between his legs out into right field. The Mets went on to score on the error. They won the game. The Mets went on to win the 7th game of the World Series. And many people looked at Buckner's error as the turning point in them losing the World Series. And then we have poor Steve Bartman. Steve Bartman wasn't a baseball player. He was a baseball fan. He was watching the NLCS, the National League Championship Series. He's a Cubs fan. Watching the game between the Cubs and the Marlins. He, like a lot of Chicago Cubs fans, were really feeling good about this year in baseball. They were winning in the game 3-0. They were up in the series. Maybe this was going to be the year that the Cubs could get that goat off their back. He was sitting along the third baseline up in the first deck when a pop fly was hit his way. Now, Steve Bartman had these headphones on. He was listening to the game, kind of watching the game, you know, it's going back and forth. And he sees this pop fly is coming to him, and like any fan, right, he stood up with other fans, tried to catch the pop fly. Unfortunately, nobody caught it. It bounced off his hand, but it prevented Moises Alou, an outfielder for the Cubs, to make an easy catch for a pop fly out. The Cubs went on to lose the game and to lose the series. Poor Steve Bartman had to be escorted out of the stadium. He received death threats for his famous blunder. Now, Fred Snodgrass died 62 years after that play in the 1912 World Series. And the New York Times printed his obituary. And the headline said, Fred Snodgrass, 86, dead, ball player muffed 1912 fly. Can you imagine that that's what you're known for in your obituary? Imagine what they'll write about Bill Buckner and poor Steve Bartman when they die. For that matter, imagine if they would have printed an obituary for Peter. For Simon Peter. It would have read, Simon Peter, 44, dead, fisherman denied Jesus 3 times. Right? History, or I guess I should say, our world has a long memory for the mistakes that people make, especially the big mistakes. The early Christians didn't forget about the time that Peter dropped the ball, literally, standing in the courtyard by a charcoal fire when people recognized him as being a follower of Jesus. And someone came up and said, hey, you're a follower of Jesus. And Peter went on famously, as we know, to deny Jesus 3 times. He was in the limelight. It was his chance to stand up to stand up for Jesus, and, you know, he let the ball drop. He let the ball go between his legs. He didn't stand up for Jesus, and it's recorded for all of perpetuity. Truth is, we should all have a soft spot in our hearts for Peter, because we've all dropped the ball many times when it comes to standing up for Jesus. We've dropped the ball many times just in life. Amen? How many of us, raise your hand if you have not forgot to pay a bill. Raise your hand if you have not missed an appointment, forgot a birthday, right? Forgot an anniversary, forgot to pick up your kid at practice, right? We've all dropped the ball in one way or another, and I could go on and on and on, but we seem to remember the people who have become famous for that one big failure. That's why they're remembered the most, like Fred Snodgrass, somebody who dies in 62 years later. Somebody's got to mention the fact that he dropped a baseball back in 1912. Or like Thomas, who one time said, "You got to, I want what you want." And he's known as the doubter, the disbeliever. And this is where Jesus could have left him with Peter, you know. He could have left Peter just wallow in that denial. And as a matter of fact, that's where he could have left it with Thomas as well. But the risen Jesus showed up a second time for Thomas. He showed up again for Simon Peter on the beach. The disciples seem to decide that they're going to call it quits, right? They're kind of living in that Holy Saturday moment where they're just not quite sure what to do. And Peter turns to the other disciples and he says, "I'm going fishing. I know what it's like to try to go back to an old job." Now, when I first got out of college, I worked here in Lemoyne in a little nonprofit company. And I worked there for a couple of years, and I decided, you know what, I need a change of pace. And so I accepted a job I had been working part-time at a Pizza Hut. I accepted the position of assistant manager at a Pizza Hut. I did that for a month, and I realized I made a huge mistake. I wasn't cut out for that. And so I left that job. I kind of floundered in another part-time job or another small job. And then the little nonprofit company that I had left said they would hire me back. And you know, they say you can never go back. Well, it's true for me when I left the job and then tried to go back to that job. It just wasn't the same. And this appears to be what's happened to the disciples. It's just not the same. They're fishing. I mean, how tough could fishing be, right? But this isn't throw your line out with a bobber kind of fishing, right? This is throwing a net off the side of the boat and dragging it up and throwing it out and dragging it up. It's long nights, it's exhausting work, and there's not a lot of profit in it. Most of the fishermen spent their time mending the nets because it was so strenuous and it was so hard on the nets, letting them dry and mending them. And on this night, the fishermen caught nothing. How much more dejected could Peter be? He failed, he thinks, at being a follower of Jesus, and now he's trying to go back to his old job, and he's not doing so well with that. But Jesus is about to do something dramatic. So after fishing all night, they have nothing for their efforts. They're fishermen, they know what they're doing, they've been skunked in terms of trying to catch something. And this stranger shows up on the beach. He says, "Hey, why don't you try throwing the net over the other side of the boat now?" For many of us, if someone we didn't know offered us a suggestion for something we didn't think they knew anything about, how would we have responded, right? We probably would have said, "Thanks, but no thanks. We tried that already." But they do throw the net over the other side. And as we know, they're overwhelmed with the response. And they're overwhelmed with the thought that this might be the risen Jesus. Peter jumps over the side after putting on some clothes, which is a whole nother sermon in and of itself. And goes to the beach to join Jesus at a charcoal fire, just like the one he was at when he denied Jesus 3 times. And he joins Jesus on the beach. Jesus pulls Peter aside and says 3 times, "Do you love me, Peter?" 3 times Peter says, "Lord, you know that I love you." It has to serve as an opportunity for Peter to be forgiven for the 3 times he denied Jesus. And each time Jesus offers him reconciliation and forgiveness, he says, "Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, and feed my sheep." There's a lesson here that we need to heed. 2 lessons, actually. The first one is, when we think we know it all, no matter how strongly we may feel God's calling in our lives, there will be times that we also will deny the Lord like Peter did. Times where we are going to be humbled, especially when it comes to the doings of Jesus Christ. So many people claim that they think they know exactly how Jesus works in this world. Exactly how he thinks, exactly how he loves. And my friends, when we think that we have Jesus figured out, or we think we have God completely figured out, know exactly how God works in the world, that is when we need to be prepared to be humbled by God. The disciples, once they felt as if they needed to face their old familiar jobs, go back to their old world, they soon learned that life without Jesus isn't any easier. But once Jesus comes back into their lives, then they realize that Jesus hasn't left them after all, that their lives now are going to take another dramatic turn. And the earlier Christians could not forget Peter's second chance, where Peter, the denier of Jesus, becomes Peter, the rock on which the church is going to be built. Peter got a second chance, just like the cross of Jesus means that we all get second chances, no matter how famous or infamous our failures are. You know, Fred Snodgrass, that outfielder in the 1912 World Series, after he dropped the ball, the very next play, he made a spectacular catch. And Fred Snodgrass went on to be a successful banker. He went on to be the mayor of Oxnard, California. And Bill Buckner, he retired from baseball. He went on to be a successful businessman. In fact, in the 2007, the beginning of the 2007 baseball season, he received a 4-minute standing ovation from the Boston Red Sox fans. That was after they won the World Series in 2006. But there was forgiveness for Bill Buckner. Steve Bartman, on the other hand, nobody knows much about Steve Bartman. In fact, he hired a publicist to keep people away from him. He just wants to go off and be anonymous, even though the world keeps trying to dig him up again when the Cubs get towards the playoffs. But it teaches us a lesson about life. And that lesson is, it's not our successes or our failures in this life that define who we are. My friends, it's the risen Christ who gives our life meaning and makes our lives sacramental. And by sacramental, I mean filled with the presence of Jesus. You see, if Christ is rooting for us, who cares what the others say about us? Christ makes us winners, but it's even more radical than that. The catch, it says, when they pulled that net in, they had 153 fish. They've argued over what this might mean, 153 fish. Somebody once said, well, that's how many known species of fish there were in the world at that time, 153. What would that mean? That would mean they caught one of every fish. That would be an all-encapsulated. Every kind of fish was caught. Of course, it ties us in with that message from Revelation that there are myriads and myriads, thousands upon thousands, worshiping God in John's vision of what heaven is like. You know, when you fish in the manner that the disciples did, the net drug in everything that got caught up in the net. The implication is this: those myriads and those myriads, that tremendous catch that the disciples had, it includes a lot of people that maybe we think shouldn't be there in the end, because of our long memories of the things that they've done. But thank the Lord that Jesus has a short memory, even though ours is long and punitive. Christ makes no distinctions. There are no qualifications. The risen Christ doesn't care about our past. The risen Christ wants to recommission us for the future. Here's my last thought. I imagine one day they're going to print my obituary. And it just may read something like this: Dave Schreffler, 110. Notice how old I'm going to be when I die, 110. Dave Schreffler, 110, dead. He wasn't only bald, but he failed as an assistant manager at Pizza Hut. And if they do, so what? The risen Jesus has my back, just like he had Peter's back, just like he had all of the disciples' back. It's the risen Jesus who gives my life and your life meaning and purpose. So even if you and I lose in this life, Jesus makes us all winners. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.